All right. Good afternoon, everyone. Oh, wait a minute. Let me turn this off here. Tune in to the Success Scholar, the Honorable One, Haki Shakur Ami here. Thank you all for tuning in, listening in. It's a beautiful day. Beautiful day here. I'm broadcasting live here at Everlasting Life in Maryland, in Capitol Heights, Maryland. 9185 Central Avenue. So thank you all for tuning in, listening in. Lots going on. Had an amazing week. Just powerful week. Had an opportunity to hang out in Arlington, Virginia at the International Firefighters Conference with some very, very, very powerful heavy hitters. But I have a very amazing guest that I'm going to be, she's going to be calling in very soon, a Sister Keena Allen. So, Sister Keena, if you're out there, if you can hear and see me. Okay. So, we're going to have a good sister calling in. Okay. Waiting for my good sister call in, Sister Keena. So, yes, but for those that are out here and yes, for those that can hear, I don't know if anybody can see me, but I just want to share a little bit about a upcoming a documentary that I recently shared in Capitol Heights, Maryland. I'm sorry, no, in Bowie, Maryland, 7 a.m. And I just got the word I'll be screening this. I'll be actually moderating a panel in New York in a couple of weeks. So looking forward to that. It's going to be an amazing event. So definitely I appreciate the opportunity. So and I'm going to go to my guests in a couple of seconds, but So definitely want to just show that. And of course, as always, I had the opportunity a few months ago in the Baltimore area. I'm sorry, let me speak directly into this mic. Had the opportunity to go to the Essence event, and the founder of Essence Magazine, one of the co-founders, attended this amazing event where he was doing a book signing. So that was an awesome opportunity. I do have copies of that. So, yes. And, of course, everyone may be interested or may be very fond of Shark Tank. So, of course, I'm a promoter and an ambassador of the Damon John Power of Broke book. So get yourself one of those. And, of course, my best-selling book, which will be on display at the Power Networking Conference, the PNC, in Capitol Heights, the Power Networking Conference coming to the Gaylord coming up in the next couple weeks, May the 25th through the... May the 25th through the 28th at the Gaylord. So stop by my table for you all that are listening. But without further ado, let me get my guest on the line. Sister Keena Allen.
Hey, how are you?
Okay, great, great, great. We're doing better now. We are actually live here. So just want to do a check. How are you coming in? Can you hear me loud and clear?
I can hear you.
Okay, well, you're definitely live and in living color here on eLife Media at the Hollett Success Scholar. And so I had the opportunity to, have a conversation with you. And so I wanted to really get into this, but, if you want to, I'll just mention, you're an author, you're a published author, and, you're very empowered with your words in terms of, transforming our community, working with various nonprofits. And you have a story of overcoming, where you show students and parents and employers how to create organizational culture that embraces the differences in the workplace, as well as showing parents how to enable their children to utilize their strengths and overcome their weaknesses. But, you're from the D.C. area, born and raised as a young child. You attended schools in the district and Montgomery County. I'm kind of reading your bio in some sense, but you also served in the United States Army as a reservist and after honorable discharge. Well, thank you for sharing that you got your honorable discharge. That's a good thing. So you weren't starting no trouble in the Army, were you?
No, we were trying to do that. That doesn't seem like something I try to do with myself, you know.
Okay.
Not a good place to do that.
Right. So and I'll definitely allow for you to put out your website. But you know, you've been interviewed on several radio shows, the Mo Better Man Show, and you know, you've done some panelist work with the National Association Medical Association Conference and in New Orleans. So you've been very well traveled, and you still work in the DC area. I'm sorry, live and work in the DC area with your son. And so just share, I mean, and we're going to talk about, you know, a very critical issue, dyslexia, you know, and, you know, you obviously, well, not obviously, but you experienced that. And so I don't know how to share, you know, that, because I don't know much about dyslexia personally. I mean, I just, sometimes you hear about it from different sources, but you kind of know that it's a disease, perhaps a disease dealing with people's inability to read. So we're going to talk about that as well as your work with your mogul chicks. So just share a little bit about, you know, just what, you know, who is Akina Allen?
Okay, so I am the product of, well, I'll tell you how I kind of got into ADA. I was adopted as a child due to my mom being schizophrenic. And I was adopted inside of my family. And so, you know, you don't really think about it. And my older brother, when we were in D.C., he was diagnosed probably having a very more severe case of dyslexia that came out. And about third grade, they were like, something's not right with her. Something's off. We can't figure it out, but something's off. There's a disconnect. So I got tested in third grade, and I began this port of discovery about myself. And as a child, it's like very frustrating because you know you can do some things, but you don't know what they are totally, and they kind of come to you in different phases. And I was very frustrated. My mother was frustrated trying to figure out what was going on with me, and I never wanted to follow the rules. It was a lot. And so as I got older, I started to take hold of what it was, because I knew I took tests a little farther than say, like I prepared 2 weeks beforehand and my work was given to me beforehand, and I would go to a resource teacher. And I knew that. Like, I knew there was something different about me and everything else. And so about junior high school, I had a teacher who told me that I was really good at poetry, that I was not really good at writing. I couldn't write a sentence. I couldn't tell you what it was.
Mm-hmm.
About high school, I started to grab a hold of it. And I remember distinctly, like, in 11th grade, I had a teacher who attempted to violate my IEP. By that time, I knew. And they put me in remedial classes for English. And everybody was like, she doesn't belong in remedial classes. This isn't, you know, remedial thinking. She needs support, but she doesn't need that support either. And so it was one particular time we did a how-to paper. And everybody did, like, something very simple because they just want to get in the process. I did Brown versus Board of Education. I just felt like that was a process. And I learned how to research. And I did that, and that, like, indented my brain. And I couldn't believe that I'd understood all the legislation on that. The next year, my junior year, I had the principal, I had the English teacher attempt to violate my IEP. And I went into the office, mind you, the racial situation anyway, and I called my special ed teacher at Springbrook High School. They will never forget this. And I promised to sue them with my paper. And I explained to the principal, I said, well, if this is a business contract, this is breach of contract. And she signed an agreement to go with my IEP.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, this is a federal law, so you're violating a federal civil rights law. And I named every single piece of legislation that came out of Brown versus Board of Education, all of it. And I said, I'll tell you what, you can not do that if you want to. I'll see you in court. Matter of fact, I'm going to file this paperwork tomorrow. I'm going to be in school tomorrow. They grabbed me, shut the door, and they said, why don't you do what everybody else why don't you do what your brother does? I said, because I wasn't born that way.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't care. I really didn't care at that point. I just saw a lot of racial undercurrent, and I just didn't care. I just didn't care. So my law teacher tried it. Like, he tried the same thing. And so him and my special ed teacher, they kind of got into it. I was like, we can go to court, and you can explain to the judge why you're violating the federal law. Not a problem. And he didn't like me. And how I started to discover who I was, I actually went into the military when I was in high school.
Mm-hmm.
I was a delayed entry. So you get to drill with a unit while you're in high school. So I was month to month, I had on BDUs. That was kind of cool. But it was in that time period of my senior year that I learned about business. And I did a business portfolio, a stock portfolio. And they were just trying to teach us remedial how to read fractions, which I kept screwing up. But when it came to business, it opened up my mind. Like, it was like amazing. And I started reading the Wall Street Journal, the Financial Times, and Investor's Business Daily, and could understand everything that was going on. Everything. And the teacher said, you know, I don't know what you are going to do when you get out of school. I do know that to make a hell of a business plan. She says, as a matter of fact, I'm going to take your portfolio that you put together and put this as my 401k. You make more logical sense than the book we just made. And the older black teacher that was in there looked at me with the biggest proud look on her face. She just couldn't believe. She was like, wow. I was a rebel. My aunt Delilah, that is not in Arcadia, I sent you her via, but I kind of get it honestly, and I just kept advocating, I kept bumping my head after high school, and, you know, dealing with the reserves, and I kept falling into entrepreneurship. I just kept along into it, and I was just like, you know, I didn't really know. I wrote the book because I'd gone through so much, and I felt like I needed to tell somebody. And then when I got pregnant with my son, I had a heart condition called tachycardia that did something. They didn't know. I did everything I was supposed to be pregnant, but they didn't know where my heart condition came from. So they told me there would be an issue with him, but I didn't know what. And with that in mind, I just kind of sort of went through the notions and just kind of pieced it together. But I understood what being a child was like. And I've taken classes, I've mentored students from special that are special needs, and I've always gravitated towards it. When I started seeing who I was, and I started knowing the gift that I had, I came alive.
Mm-hmm.
I came alive with it because it's like I was at the museum. I was at the museum, and I was with a friend of mine, makeup artist, other than my friend Sophia. Very talented young lady we met like years ago. And we were walking through this like set, and it was dark. And she was like, give me your hand. I was like, you can see because I can't see. She goes, no, I know the layout of the room. Let's go. And I almost cried in the elevator with her. This was my birthday last year. She said, no. I said, that's what it's like being dyslexic. My life is smaller than yours. And I can only see. And I said, sometimes some things are just so frustrating to me that things are showing in my face. The other side is that my intuition comes alive. And what really made me look at it in the African-American community is that as I worked with kids in different socioeconomic backgrounds, and I looked at the end result, like even now, I live in Rockville, so I could go through Potomac like every day. And there was a gentleman who gets on in Potomac with his son, who clearly has Down syndrome. And what most parents don't know is that their program that will give students with an ADA situation a job in the federal government. Now, you may not look at that as like anything big, but look at the economic ability of that income versus piecing something together. And I started looking at programs of what we could do for our children. Why this is a passion for me is because of the fact that it affects your reading and writing comprehension. And I was just I'm still in school, like I'm still finishing up my undergrad. But I took an art history course, and I didn't realize how much it would affect, but it talked about the written word. They're one of the most powerful things that has shaped society, whether it's different fonts, different colors. And when you're dyslexic, sometimes you don't get it. And some things you get, you can't put your finger on them. And so I wrote this book so that I can inspire people and parents and say, no, they have all the tools. It's a processing. Dyslexia is a process. It's a cognitive processing issue. That it takes you longer to get the visual of what you're doing and what you're being asked in writing. And that's what it is. And sometimes there's things that your brain dumps, there are things that your brain keeps. And what I try to show people, especially parents and children within our community, is find out what your child does best. Find out the gift. Because Graham's Model of 96 says that you can utilize your strengths to pull your weaknesses. What happens is that they teach in our community learned helplessness so that they can make money off of our population. I've read a book called 1,000 CEOs. There's a special section in there called Dyslexic CEOs. Not a person of color was in there. I read Forbes Dyslexic CEOs. Not a person of color in there. I recently, as I think I sent you a text or email that said I was shopping, I spoke to someone about a business plan that I wrote. He says, why, what makes you good at this? And I said, because I'm dyslexic. I see what you don't see. I said, I can stand in front of anybody and tell you why this will work. I know my theory. Trust me. I'm good at this. And I've been able to stand on the skill set of dyslexia in a powerful way where I'm not ashamed of it. I'm not hiding it. And I want people not to hide behind it because people know that dyslexics do really good things in business. Shark Tank is full of people that do it. Half the panel, more than half the panel on Shark Tank is dyslexic. There's a reason for it. There's a reason why they're successful because there's an intuition that they have for them. And I know it. I want our community to know it. Because it seems like it's held in a bottleneck. Because people make more money off you being confused. Period. And so, will somebody try to quiet me by the time I try to get this out? Probably. Do I care? No. I think you have to stand bold. You have to stand firm. You have to be steadfast and unmovable in who you are. Because if not, being dyslexic will make you depressed. And that is what that is. I'm an outside the box thinker. I am the person that will try the rules because I see some other way. I'm the person that has the bad feelings. I'm fabrication. Is it hard? Yes. It is hard. I'm not going to tell you it's a cakewalk. It's not. I have friends who help me with various things. There's a friend who helped me come back to school. I was just like, I can't do the writing thing. And she's like, yes, you can. I'm going to show you. And she showed me. And the first time I got like an A or B in a paper, I was so proud because I did it by myself. I was like, I can't do this. Yes, you can. I maintain a 3.0 average. All my classes are online, and they're all for writing, and extensive writing. And I had to learn how I learned and learn how I practiced for that reason. So it's a strengthening thing. It's definitely a strengthening situation. And I keep my son that, and I always tell him to find this gift. Mom, you're always talking about that. I said, because the world will tell you so many times what it is that you can't do. I need you to stand firm on what you know you can do. And so, you know, that's who I am.
Yeah, all right, phenomenal. So what is your, what would you say, you know, for people that are listening in and they you know, say, okay, is there any help I mean, do you attempt to help people that are dyslexic? Or, I mean, of course you can help everyone, you know, but are you saying that you are trying to reach out for special needs individuals or people? I mean, and well, let me first ask you, do you consider those that are, you know, dyslexic as being special needs persons?
Not so much. I think the label special needs is derived because people do not know how to understand the talent of a dyslexic person.
Okay.
And I think that is, they call it special needs because they're like, we don't put them to this box. We have to handle them with a special type of needs because we need to consume them more on this side. And that's what it is. It's about conformity.
Right. Okay. Now, you were recently, now explain, and shout out to Miss Odessa, my mother Odessa, Sister Odessa, up in New York, by way of New York, by way of Prince George's County. So, your BWO. So, what was going on with the businesswoman online? Share with the listening audience exactly what that is in your role.
Is a wonderful network of women who I have actually met over the past, say, 2-3 years, because I also do radio, I'm producing. And so I met them inadvertently, and as I started to, when I wrote my book and started getting things together, I met them, and I came across them, and I was posting stuff, and I just decided to go ahead and, you know, have her kind of mentor me along with promotion and marketing and things like that. She helped pick my brain together, because sometimes you have like 20 million thoughts. It's almost like a circus has, you know, decided to set up shop and unleash all the ringleaders or something.
Mm-hmm.
So I tend to like either call her or do that so she can kind of say, oh, I'll focus here, right here, in the middle, right here, right here. So that's what she does with me. I'm a little special, and she knows it. So I really like it, and she has lots of information, and this is a really good, wonderful network of women that share, and it's almost like having your own directory of people. There's not too much of an overlap of that, and so it's like, okay, I need this person here, okay, here you go. You know, because sometimes I'm writing things down, and she's like, "Can you just calm down? Stop being hyper. Just calm down. I'll be fine. You can get through this. Breathe." So it's definitely a wonderful organization to promote that. And I ended up doing mogul checks. I mean, you asked about mogul checks, right?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So I was just doing T-shirts like last summer. And just something to share my income. I had wrote the book. And I was getting everything together. And I was just like, I want to do this. I always have these really interesting, snappy phrases. And so I have a friend by the name of Libby Anderson. And she's a friend. And I might have to do another site or whatever. So we became pretty cool. And so she's like, she called it mogul chick. Why? She said, okay, every time I talk to you, you're talking about business principles. Different things you're learning in class. Or, you know, I'm always sending her stuff from school. And I realized, you know, that what I was doing was taking a hold of me being dyslexic as a mogul chick. Mogul chick is a woman who knows her gifts, her talents, and abilities. She's a woman that runs everybody else's world on her fingers, but she could run her own. And so she can get fulfillment out of it. And I felt like women as a whole, our talents are utilized for every other purpose. But we very rarely say, what can we do for ourselves? And so the mogul chick quotes, I think you've seen like some of them or whatever, they're on Instagram, but I think I put them on Facebook. My mogul chick quotes come out of things in my head because I am a property manager in D.C., condo manager specifically.
Mm-hmm.
And I have faced the various levels of sexism and racism within the last year. Mm. And there are things, there are times on there, I want to say things, but that will get me in trouble. So I write them down. took a nice little pretty thing, and I go from there. But I found out, as women coming into my office, everything from rocket scientists to lawyers, to corporate lawyers, and mogulship, honestly, was kind of birthed out of the frustration of Black millennial young ladies. And I was sitting there with two women who came out of Ivy League, they came out of Yale. And one of them found out she was dyslexic in her junior year at Yale. And the meeting was for us to kind of sit down and go over ways, you know, just so she can kind of discover what it is that she could do. She knew some things, but she was still in the dark about a lot. So I was like, okay, fine. And she started talking to me, her and her friend started talking to me about their experience in corporate America. Coming from Ivy League schools, girls went to Yale and Princeton. What other Ivy League are you going to look at? Harvard? And so they talked about being passed over for promotions. They talked about how everybody from every other demographic was given, if they created something, they were given a raise. This one young lady created something, a transcript. She worked in an international firm. And she, her whole thing was to put Africa on the map in a different way. And she did transcripts with people from all over the world, from Africa, that were in different countries. Mm-hmm. And they liked it, and they got a contract from it. And the sister asked for a raise. They told her it was not in the budget, but you just signed a $1 million contract? Yeah. She's frustrated. So actually, I don't just have two books. I don't just have that one book. I have three books. I wrote, there's a work guide that for Black millennial women that they sat down and they told me what they wanted to know and what they were experiencing. And they said Lean In didn't apply to them. They said in order to get to Lean In, they got to want to mentor me. She says, Donut Chick got a chance to go to some foreign country to do some work in the field. It was an international firm. And I said, she says, Donut Girl did that. And I said, well, Donut Girl must have been over the table. And she laughed, but she said, no, that's probably what happened. And we laughed about it, but it was real. I mean, like, I had women who were sitting next to what's funny. I'm trying to tell what's funny. And there were women just, like, sitting there just talking. These were all highly educated Black women. So, Mobile Chicks is also an ode to the women of color who, like myself, go through situations where I am the only Black face standing there. And people don't think I understand what they're doing. I'm just in the classroom what they're doing. I work with the majority of men, white men. And people don't think I understand what they're doing. I understand they lie. I just don't tell them everything. I was at a dinner the other day, not long ago, and I said, you know, I get reprimanded for being strong. I get reprimanded for not letting you walk on me. I get reprimanded for not being a doormat. And when I look around, I'm the only person that has my back. Because the people who say they have my back are only doing it as a patronizing situation. It's a leverage. And it's a control mechanism. It's all I have your back is your sword here. No. America's, I can do this. So, yeah, I have battles that I fight. I mean, they say, oh, because you're dyslexic. And I said, let me find something to you. It may take me longer to write that report, but I can tell you things that you aren't seeing. And I get that a lot. And it is a struggle to maintain a level of dignity and to keep your head on the swivel, because the building that I manage is in a very posh neighborhood. So I have a lot that I fight.
Wow.
And it is a cakewalk.
Beautiful. So we're going to go to a quick break, sis. So if you're tuning in, you tune in to Holla the Success Scholar on eLife Medium here each and every Monday, 8 to 9 p.m. So I'm here with Sister Akina Allen. So we're going to go to a quick break and come right back on the other side. Thank you. We're live. We're back. We're back. You're tuned in to Holla at the Success Scholar with the Honorable One, Asafo, the Success Scholar himself, Hakeem Shakur Ami. Thank you all for tuning in and listening in here to this powerful broadcast here. And I'm here each and every Monday night, 8 to 9 p.m., broadcasting live from Everlasting Life in Capitol Heights, Maryland, 9185 Central Avenue. We just had a phenomenal time speaking with a good sister, but before we get back, we had some lovely, lovely tunes being played. Of course, a local artist, and I'll just mention that name towards the end of that local artist that we played. But I want to mention the eLife Media lineup here. We run different times, mostly in the evenings. But let me mention some of the shows. You got Rob Hall and the Hall Street Journal. Hall Street Journal instead of the Wall Street Journal. All right, Mondays 7 to 9 a.m. So he's the early morning brother, the drive time morning show with Brother Rob Hall. Andrew Sewell with Coffee Everywhere, Mondays 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. Kim Robinson, Keep It Moving Show 2. Keep It Moving Show 2. Mondays, 11 to 1 p.m. Todd Ewing, The Heaven in Every Blackface, Monday, 6 to 7 p.m. Rolling Grimes, The Rolling Grimes Show with LaTanya Mosley, Monday, 7 to 8 p.m. And, of course, Hakeem Ami, Monday, 8 to 9. Holla at the Success Scholar. And The Dr. Baruch Show is on Tuesdays through Thursdays, 11 to 1 p.m. And definitely check that out. And Slick Daddy Rick, Slick Daddy Rick Hart Beat Congo Hour, Tuesday, 8 to 9 p.m.
That's last week, right?
Yes, yes, yes. Okay, thanks. So, yeah, so definitely, brothers and sisters, thank you all. I mentioned the last few shows coming up here. We got a few, DJ Good Vibes, Good Vibes Show, Wednesday, 6 a.m. to 6 to 8. Dwayne T, we got a whole list of people. Dwayne TV, Smokey Unrestricted Radio Show, 8 to 10. Dodge Center, the Veterans Report. Ah, we got a veteran show. Hey, Akina, we got a veteran show on here.
Okay.
All right. Let me mention a few other things. The Real Estate Life Talk with Ebony's Thursday, 1 to 3 p.m. Dr. Maya Up On It, Dr. Maya Show, and 8 to 10 p.m. And Kenya Pope, Sister Goodness the Goddess, Friday, 10 to 2. DJ Drew, The Rush Hour. That's Friday evenings, 5 to 7. Glory Gang, Friday Night Glory. 7 to 9 p.m. Friday, and the Afro District Show, Saturday, 7 to 9 p.m., and Dennis Green, Inside the Green Room, Sunday, 4 to 6 p.m. So, with that being said, brothers and sisters, I'd like to thank you all. I'm joined by a wonderful, wonderful sister. So, we're going to get this pumped up here for this, empowering sister that's doing some amazing things. Anybody that's going to call their movement Mogul Chicks, you know, they about it. And that's why I said, all right, let me get this sister on. You know, she's reading the books. You know, she's down with one of my favorite shows, Shark Tank. So, you know, me and my sweetheart, we watch that, you know, faithfully every Friday night. So we are Shark Tanks. And, of course, for those that are listening in, you know, I do have the Power of Broke book. And hopefully if you are smart enough, shall I say, to come to the PNC conference, I will have copies available of The Power of Broke, utilizing your power of broke, as Brother Damon John of Shark Tank. And he's one, actually. And if you are just tuning in right now, we are talking about dyslexia, you know, and as well as success, you know, because we don't want to just dwell on, you know, perceived handicaps, you know. And as Sister Keena Allen of Mogul Chicks and has expressed that, you know, you have to use, as you said, you used your dyslexia as a force. If I'm saying that right, you use that as a force, as a motivation, as an inspiration to drive yourself.
Yes, I do. I do that because, like I said before, within our community, this is what it is. This is what I want parents to know. When your child is diagnosed with dyslexia, or any what they call invisible disability, one of the things that happens is that you get what I call a death sentence. And I think that when I spoke at the National Medical Association, I spoke to a doctor, and she was just like, I can't believe you're dyslexic. My granddaughter was dyslexic, and they told me that the only thing she would be doing is cleaning buildings. Nothing wrong with that. There's plenty of cleaning companies. But the fact that they gave her such a bad forecast about her life is so crazy. I had a friend and her children and my son went to school in Washington Latin. And her daughter was dyslexic. But the outcome and how they showed her how to use her strength was totally different than what we did. So one of the things I tell parents is that if you think your child has a suspected issue, a processing issue, go see a developmental pediatrician. Mm. First thing you do. We don't know about those, but when I did special needs training, and I mean, when I worked with special needs children, there was a school called WVSA Fail, and these children were the byproduct of the crack epidemic, okay? There were kids that were there that it was just amazingly sad, okay? And these children were just ticking time bombs. And so I literally worked with these kids, and I'll tell you a crazy story. I was mentoring one young man, And this brother, he had like 9 siblings and 9 different fathers with those siblings. So he was in 8th grade, and his brother was in the 4th grade with my son. And this is just why we need to put our hands in the community.
Yes.
So my son had locks. He decided he wanted to have locks. Okay, fine, whatever. Let's just get it. And his locks were neat. You know, we kept them clean and we kept them groomed, things like that. Well, this other young man, his locks just really didn't look all that pulled together. And he was teased a lot. And we were in the grocery store on Potomac Avenue. And my son was like, oh, yeah, Mom, Malik was teased. And I was like, what do you mean? He said, well, Malik has been teased and everything else. And I said, that's not nice. Next thing I know, my son says, Mom, Malik bought a gun to school. Malik put a kind of gun at me. I said, who? My whole brain oozed out of my ears. Completely oozed out of my ears. What are you in the 4th grade doing with a gun? And my son has the ability of being calm. Actually, the only child I know who came to the world and was quiet. And so, as a parent, your mind goes blank. And I went back. I actually raised hell on the phone with that school. And I mean, that's not the first time I have commenced to help shutting down the school for being dysfunctional with children. I have all the time in the world for you to get it together. I think I told one principal or one administration, I said, I'll tell you what, you don't fix this, I'm going to the Justice Department, I'm cutting off your funding. I'm going to Congress. We're going to have a nice conversation. So, I've done that. I said, I guess what? We'll just fix this. I'll go talk to the Justice Department. Then you can talk to them about that. They saw it my way. And so, when I looked at this, I was mentoring his older brother. And the year before that, one child had gotten killed from domestic violence. Him, his brother, and his mom were killed by the hand of her boyfriend.
Wow.
And I don't know if you've ever gone to a funeral and you watch babies be in a casket, but it's one of the most disturbing things I've ever seen in my life. Exactly, like one of the most disturbing things you can see. And I tell people, kids don't need lattes. Kids need you in the classroom. They need your hand in our community, because I mentored his brother in the second year after that happened. All of a sudden, they were like, Miss Allen, come here. And we think there's something going on in the household. And now you're not just a reading buddy to him. You're a mentor. Talk to you. So we need you to sit down with Jerome. Because Jerome talks to you. We know he talks to you. And we suspect some things were going on in the household. And my son used to get offended when he goes to school and kids would run up and hug me. He said, where are their parents? I said, well, you know, he said, well, why do they always come and hug you? Or why do they call you Mom? He goes, well, what is that? But we need to be in the school. We need to show our face. We need to take some time. You can get cute some other time period. I mean, you're in a classroom. I need you to show up when it ain't popular. Don't just show up. Pop up. See what they doing. My son told me now, he was homeschooled for 2 years. So he says, Mom, please don't show up at my school. Mom, please don't show up.
Right.
Don't show up.
Right.
But you just have to be that parent. They don't see a number of colored faces in school. They don't. And I think that when we do that, that makes your mogul check. That says, no, I'm controlling this. Let's get that straight.
Wow.
You don't control this. I'm running this. You got any problems? You got to eat that. But I'm running this. It makes a difference. It makes a difference. I think that being dyslexic, I see all types of stuff. And I use it to my advantage.
Right.
To argue dyslexic, okay, and yes. It may take me longer to write that sentence, but I don't know if you follow me and what is that buddy's name? What is his name? Martin?
What's the name?
What is this Marty Nickens? He might be actually listening to us right now.
Okay. What's up, Marty?
Marty might be listening to us now. Me and Marty have a ball when we talk about businesses. I don't know if you ever like to see a conversation, but we always talk about, we just finished talking about in the marketplace.
Okay.
Business enthuses me. Business taught me how to read.
Hmm.
That's why I like business.
Right.
Business taught me how to read.
Hmm.
I didn't grab anything until I started reading the Wall Street Journal.
Hmm.
I grabbed poetry.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm able to look at a merger or an acquisition and tell you some things. I'm challenged. I knew that the MCI WorldCom merger was going to be a flop.
Wow.
Here's the funny part. In my book, I kept going into, what do you call it? Entrepreneurship. So the year I got pregnant with my son, I ended up in business for myself in, at a New York Life office in Bethesda. And I came off disability. I had a back injury. My lawyer worked it out where I was off all winter until the spring. And I did some stimping, and they were like, oh, we don't have anything, yeah. And I was like, you need something on these offices here. You have not gone in on these floors. There's like 15 different floors in here. I said, okay. I said, nothing, walked out of the air and walked into somebody's office. In my book, it tells you, like, some of the audacious stuff that I did. I didn't even care. But what the book also talks about is us going through a shelter and how I didn't understand how to kind of conceptualize my gift to maneuver as a business woman because I didn't have a mentor. And that's why I really thank God for people like Odessa Hawkins who do that for me.
Right.
Because we went through that. And I was like, I felt so crazy. The mother like, oh my God, as intelligent as I am, why are we in D.C. General? And they told me, like, you don't belong here, but what it gave me a chance to do was to look at what was going on with our people in the cradle to the grave. And even while I was in D.C. General, I was helping people with special education students. And there's a boy by the name of Khalil, and he was on time psychotropic medication. And she had asked D.C. Public Schools to help her. And the administrator told her that there were much worse cases. What worse case is that? You have a six-year-old on top psychotropic medication. And if he doesn't get it, he turns into the Tasmanian devil. So you want him in jail. That's what you're telling me. And one of the things I realized is that the majority, like half of the people that were in there that were recycled had children that were special needs that they never got a chance to keep in school, so they can't keep a job, so you go back into a system. It's recycling. And they get used to feeding them what they want, and they get complacent and never try because they feel like they can't. A lot of them aren't really literate. Education's not something that has been stressed. That experience helped me to actually, we got out of that whole experience within 9 months. We looked at transitionals, I looked at everything, and then I was on a project at Howard, and I ended up with a consulting project.
Yes.
Okay. So, it was something out of the ordinary, and I ended up with another consulting project, and it was just like, you know, you don't fit here. And one of the things I also found out with that system was that they don't have things for highly or for educated people that are beyond high school.
Right.
They don't. And so I took that experience. I talked to Dr. Adi Tolson about what I was going through. I just talked to him a lot, Judge Burnett. And at one point, Judge Burnett wanted to write the systemic depression or, you know, where it came from and why it did in our community and, like, the effects of it. And I wrote about my experience. And I can find an email to send it to you, but he presented it to the American Psychological Association with Louis Gates.
Okay. Well, let's pivot a little bit, sister. Thank you. Yeah, that was certainly a good breakdown of your operations. But you have, and I want to definitely give another shout out to Sister Odessa for we had a conversation, you and I, about someone that we share, as a dear friend and supporter and mentor in a sense. And about maybe a year ago, I had the opportunity to I did actual training, a 2-day training with Dr. Willie Jolly, and before I
actually, yes.
And before I actually did that, you know, I talked to Sister Odessa. I was like, all right, well, you know, what did you kind of get? I mean, I've been seeing Dr. Willie Jolly from over some time, and you know, and after I was in the book with Les Brown, I was like, well, yeah, of course I could fly down to, you know, Florida to take a training with Les Brown, but I'm like, look, I mean, Dr. Willie Jolly is our, you know, around the way man, you know, so
uh-huh.
I'm like, so, you know, I mean, you see one, you see the other, so I'm like, let me go ahead and sign up for this boot camp training. He's right here, right down the street. So I kind of just use good judgment to say, I just had such a wonderful, wonderful 2-day training with him. It was only like three of us having, you know, a real one-on-one type of interaction. So, you know, like a boot camp style from 8 in the morning till like 5 or 6 in the evening. So we went strong for 2 full days.
Wow, it was just amazing. That's a lot.
Yeah. It was an awesome training. It just built my confidence. Sometimes, you know, we have to pay it forward. We have to, say that we put in the work. You know, we showed up. Of course, you know, sometimes you gotta show up. You know, you can't just be out on Facebook chatting and saying, yeah, I'm a coach, I'm a author, or I'm a speaker, but you know, it's like there, you know, you got to pay your price, you know, and I mean, if you expect to be in, you know, on some levels, you know, learn from those that have done something close to what you want to do, and not that I'm going to be exactly like Dr. Willie Jolly in every aspect, and of course none of us can duplicate, you know, but you get some good nuggets and you learn what not to do, you know, and I've done that, you know, with seeing him over the past few years and really going through his more in-depth training. So share, you know, your experiences with working with Dr. Willie Jolly as well as his wife. And that's, you know, I was like, yeah, I'm definitely gonna have this sister on. She's, you know, connecting the dots, showing up at the right places, and you know, being mentored by the right individual. So share with the listening audience your experiences with working with Dr. Willie Jolly.
Oh well, Dr. Jolly and I met. Plus, actually, he met me. We were going through the shelter situation, and then I was at the Renee Allen show when he was there at WBLS. And he's like, you're dyslexic? And I said, yes. He says, McGregor is dyslexic. I said, really? He says, yes. And we need someone to help her. So I actually ended up working with her and just unlocking her brain. I think, just like with anything else, you kind of get this downtrodden diagnosis. And it's like, how can I do this? And you kind of feel ashamed. So you spend more time hiding what you don't know instead of learning showing what you really can do. And I have kept a good relationship with him. I consider them both very good people. Miss D, she teaches me like different pieces, like there's like the Office of Human Rights. She saw that same thing, right? The Office of Human Rights. They're like a week on me. And so I talked to her about that, and she coaches me. Like, she's like a mom. She's like the aunt that will snatch you calmly and say, come here, sit right here next to me. I have to talk.
Mm-hmm.
So when she does, I go, okay, I did that one wrong. And I utilize what she, you know, what they both impart on me. But I think it's important to have people like them around you because you need mentorship to groom you, to get to that next level. Everything that they actually do may not be comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
You have to step out your comfort zone to do and to work with people, but to be open to working with them. So anytime you tell me something, I write it down. I try to remember everything, and Odessa will tell you some stuff. He's hard-headed. Getting out of that phase.
Right.
But it's important. It's so important to see your goal and know that you need help. And you find people like Dr. Jolly and Ms. D and Odessa and other people that can see and kind of chisel away and weed out, you know, pull the weeds out the garden. You know, you don't need this. Put this in trash. You need that. You really need that if you want to be successful. If you refuse, you gotta stay where you are. Wow. Don't ask for help.
Wow. Yeah, well, and let me apologize. We had some technical difficulties with our phone system. You know, this is a new station, so let me just let everybody know to bear with us. And the storm knocked out our system, so you know, our phones were not able to, you know, we couldn't get any caller. And so, Akina, I apologize to you, but we'll try to certainly get you back again here. Really soon, but let me let you begin to, you know, give a couple, you know, minutes you know, and close us out here. And we went a little past time, but it was all good. We started a little late, so we okay. But let the listening audience know exactly what you have planned, any events coming up, any books you have coming up, and any contact information or any inspiring words.
Okay, so you can go to my website, www.changedthinking.com, mm-hmm. and you're going to see mogul chips, you're going to see my bio, and you're going to see some music from this area's artists, Subliminal Thought and Khalil and Say Two. And they're DC artists, they're very, very talented, so I encourage you to click on and look at their bios, listen to their music. That's my urban street thing. I think it's important to support your local artists. They're entrepreneurs as well. So I have another book that's coming out, and I'll start talking more about like the day in the life of being dyslexic and what I go through and the ups and downs on it. Mogul Chick has a campaign that I'm going to be doing called I Am STEM. The reason being is because people pay money for lots of flashy things. They will come to our neighborhoods for football and basketball and dancing and singing. But I want to see your brain. I want to know, and I want sisters and little sisters to know that you don't have to shake anything. Shake your head. Let them know that you can think. Let them know that you are built for intelligence. You're not just built for show.
Mm-hmm.
And next year, and I'm going to get an underwriter for this, but I want to put on the science show. And it's going to be cute. It's going to be posh. I'm going to do it in probably your urban neighborhood, probably in Anacostia someplace. Because it's called Let Me See Your Brain. So I'm kind of gathering that up right now for next year. Something small, but there's two things that's going to happen. One, I want to see them think. I want them to even think outside the box. Number two, I want them to collectively know how to appreciate each other's gifts and talents and ability and know how to work together. There's so much competition that is turning to fighting and violence in our schools.
Mm-hmm.
The kids are killing each other. And one of the things we need to do early is teach them how to properly network with each other.
Mm.
So they get further. They say, oh, I'm going to see her again, not because it's a rival situation, but I need to know what that's supposed to do. We may need to work together and do some business together. We need to come together and do a project together. We need to collectively do this.
Mm.
We need to collectively do this instead of saying, yeah, we're going to do this and don't do it.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, we're going to do this here. No, stop being cute. Take those heels off and go teach that child how to be a lady. That's what I need you to do. Get something between her ears.
Mm.
Because everything else is fine. And I think that is what we need to do, is collectively build each other up. We need to teach them. Because if we don't, we're not going to have a generation.
Mm.
We're not. It's going to be very blighted, as certain areas of our city is.
Mm-hmm.
You have got to make that a focal point. What are we doing in our community that says, yes, you can be different?
Mm.
And you are talented, you're brilliant, and you were made just the way you are, and you're fine. What are we teaching our kids? And that is what I want people to say is, if you do nothing else with your child tonight, say, find out what it is that your child does best.
Right.
Find out what it is that you do best. Not focus so much on what they can't do. We already know that.
Mm.
But help your child find their gift and their talent and their ability.
Right.
And their strength.
Mm.
That is what I want you to do. Because the world is supposed to beat them down and tell them all that they can't do. And show them what they can't do. You have to show them that, no, you were built this way. You're good at this. This is why you're good at it. This is what you can do. These are your options in life.
Right, right.
This is what we have to do. As a collective, especially as a business community. Don't just say we're here. Do something. Don't just sit there. Do something.
Mm.
Don't just say, oh, those kids are crazy. Okay, what are you doing about it? Roll your sleeves up, get your hands dirty, because this is not going to be pretty work.
Hmm. All right. All right. Well, I definitely appreciate you, sister. You gave out your contact information for those that, you know, want to get in touch with you. And I want to thank you for joining me here on Holla at the Success Scholar. I appreciate the opportunity. Appreciate your time with being here. And I'll definitely get you a copy of this interview. And we'll get back with you soon. And I'm sure I shall see you around. All right.
All right. It was great being here. Anytime.
Thank you. Thank you very much. All right, sis. Peace.
Take care.
All right. I'm going to get like three minutes. All right. Cool. Yeah. Just want to do something real fast here. All right. Just want to close us out real fast. All right. Oh, excuse me. Let me close out. I'm looking at one of the shows here. So thank you all, brothers and sisters. I'm sorry. Pardon my delay here. With that, we had a wonderful sister on Holla at the Success Scholar radio show, Sister Kimberly Allen. Oh, shoot. Let me make sure this is good here. I want to have to plug something up here. Oh, man. All right. So I apologize, but definitely I want to thank everybody for tuning in here to this broadcast here with Holla at the Success Scholar. Definitely we broadcast here each and every Monday night at 8 to 9 p.m. at Everlasting Life. And we will have that show up in a couple days or a day or so. And in the meantime, you can go to eLife Media on Ustream, as well as on YouTube, and see some of our previous shows. Definitely the one.
Also on the website, eLifeMedia.net.
Also on the website at eLifeMedia.net. So definitely, look on videos. So I saw several of the videos up there, but hopefully some of the highlights the Success Scholar will be up there. So thank you all for tuning in. We apologize, but definitely our sound will be up next week. So you all that I wasn't able to get to, you will be able to hear those shows. I'll have a link for you. So we couldn't get it. I know. I'm sorry. So I just wanted to shout out my live Facebook Live people. I couldn't run it while I was doing my show, so I had to do the sound. I learned that last week that I couldn't do both. So I wanted to let everybody know from my Facebook Live that I was live today. We had a good sister on. Akina Allen was on the radio with us and with her mogul chick. So definitely I want you to stick around here. We're going to do this again. I hope to see you, Sister Sheila. I hope you come into the PNC, Power Networking Conference, maybe. And we're going to work on a few other things coming up here in the next couple of weeks. But next week I'll be back. Have an awesome show lined up next week, so tune in, and we'll speak to you all soon. Peace. Oh, shoot.